October 27, 2015, regular meeting of the Troy Planning Commission. Copies of the agenda for tonight's meeting are available at the entrance to the room. Additionally, the agendas and minutes of prior meetings are available on the city's website. The meeting will be conducted in accordance with the agenda as presented or amended by the Planning Commission. The roles and responsibilities of the Planning Commission are outlined on the reverse side of tonight's agenda. State law establishes planning commissions. The commission is comprised of 9 members, all of whom have volunteered to serve. Members are appointed by the mayor and confirmed by city council. The other individuals seated at the table this evening are representatives of the city's planning department, the city attorney's office, and the city's planning consultant, Carlisle Wortman Associates. If you wish to address the planning commission, please come forward when recognized and provide your name and address on the sign-in sheet. Please begin your remarks by stating your name for the benefit of the commissioners. All remarks are to be addressed to the planning commission and not to anyone else in the room. At this time, I ask that all cell phones, Blackberries, PDAs, or any other devices that might disrupt this meeting, please either be placed in silent mode or be turned off. Ms. Sarnicky, the roll call, please.
Mr. Apiedian?
Here.
Ms. Cruz?
Here.
Mr. Edmonds?
Here.
Mr. Faison?
Here.
Mr. Hudson?
Here.
Mr. Krent?
Here.
Ms. Kupa?
Here.
Mr. Zanzika? Mr. Jagel?
Here.
Foreign present. Item number 2 on the agenda is the approval of the agenda. I have a motion to approve. Mr. Apiedian, support. Mr. Faison.
Ms. Cruz?
Yes.
Mr. Edmonds?
Yes.
Mr. Faison?
Yes.
Mr. Hudson?
Yes.
Mr. Krent?
Yes.
Ms. Kupa?
Yes.
Mr. Tagle?
Yes.
Mr. Apiedian?
Yes.
Agenda item number 3 is the minutes of the October 13, 2015. Could I please have a motion to approve as published?
I'll make a motion.
Thank you, Ms. Cruz.
Second
by Mr. Tagle.
Mr. Edmonds?
Yes.
Mr. Faison?
Yes.
Mr. Hudson?
Yes.
Mr. Krent?
Yes.
Ms. Kupa?
Yes.
Mr. Tagle?
Yes.
Mr. Apiedian?
Yes.
Ms. Cruz?
Yes.
Agenda number 4 is the public comment for items that are not on the agenda. Is there anyone in the audience who wants to speak to an item that is not on the agenda? Hearing no one, we'll move on to item number 5, the Zoning Board of Appeals report. I wasn't there, but I did understand that all the items were approved. Is that correct?
That's correct, based on the email that Mr. Sanziki provided us.
Yeah, and maybe we can. I don't even know what the items were.
Okay.
So, were you there?
No. I think I assumed you were going to talk about it, and you assumed I was going to talk about it.
Right.
And neither one of us is prepared to talk about it.
Right.
So what we can do is we can send the minutes to all the Planning Commission members.
I think that'd be very appropriate.
So they can read by it.
Thank you. Okay, we'll move on to item number 6. The Downtown Development Authority report.
There was a quarterly meeting last Wednesday morning. The DDA discussed a number of things. There were staff updated them on the Troy Roads Walk 2 efforts along Big Beaver related to road construction. We gave them an update on Move Across Troy, which is the effort to improve pedestrian walkability along and across Big Beaver. And I presented a planning and zoning report, and Mark Miller discussed the issue of the desire of the Planning Commission and City Council at our last joint meeting, how we talked about increased density and height along Big Beaver. We had an informal dialogue about that. And they were generally in support of the concept.
Good. Thank you. Okay, number 7 is planning and zoning report, Mr. Savage.
Those of you watching City Council last night, the street vacation request for the alley behind the proposed Amber apartments and lofts that recently was conditionally rezoned in August, that was approved last night unanimously. We last week received applications for 3 more hotels near Big Beaver.
Wow.
Yeah. 2 of them north of the... And we just received them last week, so we haven't even got all our comments back internally. We haven't jumped in and reviewed them, and we have not had our development committee report, which is we bring all departments in and have a dialogue about the plans. We haven't even done that yet, so I can't even speak really intelligently about both applications. But one is for two hotels north of Wilshire. You know, Wilshire kind of terminates north of former Magna property, now NSI. Two hotels there, a six-story and a four-story. And then an A-loft on the PNC Bank building, formerly the Top of Troy building, in the parking lot behind it near the detention base.
How many stories was that?
Do you recall any stories? I don't recall. Again, hot off the presses. Okay. I know the two off of Wilshire were six stories and four stories. So, yeah, we just received them. I haven't even had a chance to speak intelligently about them. Yeah.
Would they be taking existing buildings and repurposing them? So this is land that's available. Okay.
Yeah, it's the NSI building stay as is, and there's a parcel that's north of that where the two hotels are proposed.
Man.
Mr. Chair, I believe there may be someone who just walked in who would have spoken in public comment for items not on the agenda, but okay. I could be correct. I could be incorrect.
Yeah.
Have you signed in yet, sir?
No.
Thank you.
Yeah, my name is John Sharp. I'm the president of the Wilshire Muir Homeowners Association, and we are residents immediately to the west of the parcel that they're proposing to build these two monstrous hotels on. This property was originally owned by Magna. At the time that Magna bought it, there was extensive negotiation resulting in a development agreement which was recorded, and the city is aware of it. That development agreement lasts for 30 years, so it's got 10 years more to run. And pursuant to that agreement, everything north of the south line of our subdivision is supposed to be only used for parking. These hotels would be built on that parcel that is reserved for parking and to be developed according to that development agreement. So it's a complete violation of the development agreement between our subdivision association, the Washington Square Development Association, the condo association that comes south of Waddles, I forget the name of it. We were all three parties to that agreement along with Magna, and that agreement runs with the land. But besides that, this parcel has been designated as part of the Big Beaver Corridor development, but it's not part of Big Beaver. It never touches Big Beaver. It doesn't go south of a line north of Wilshire Boulevard. And there's no other development in north of that line that's commercial anywhere east of Coolidge Highway. Everything else that's commercial development on that fronts on Big Beaver is south of that line. And I don't want to look out my backyard and see a six-story hotel, which I think is completely inconsistent with residential development, and the 88 homeowners that I represent, we do not want to have that hotel there looking down on our properties. There's currently, as part of the development agreement, and it was complied with by Magna when they owned the property, a beautiful berm that has been built there. It's 12 foot high with evergreens on top of it. Under this proposal, that berm would be moved, would be ripped out. It would be moved almost 180 feet west so that it would be right on our property line, and it would be doubled in height. It would be 25 feet. And that's inconsistent with the residential character of our neighborhood. And I just don't think that, given that the whole idea when our neighborhood was originally built was there would be large buildings on Big Beaver, fronting Big Beaver, such as the old Volkswagen building, which probably don't remember what that was, but now says New World Order on it. And then shorter office buildings, such as the Wilshire Plaza buildings, and then the Magna building, which is in keeping with that character. And then it would step down to residential development north of the line that our subdivision is built on. And if by building a large multi-story hotel north of that line is inconsistent with what that whole development idea was when it was originally put together. And I just think that's not in keeping with the trust that our residences have put into our elected officials and they vested in this planning commission. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. We just became aware of this not more than 2 minutes before you came in.
Yes, Mr. Sharp, isn't it true that if there's a development agreement, which has 10 years of vitality left,
right,
you had a remedy in circuit court for injunctive relief in a breach of that agreement?
Well, we could, but I don't know that we need to shoulder the burden of having to pursue a remedy in court if we show that to this Planning Commission and to the council that agreement was negotiated and it's still binding effect. You guys don't want to be doing something that's against a recorded agreement as well.
Thank you.
Okay.
Have you requested a meeting with the developers?
I just found out about this today.
Okay, so did we. Okay, thank you very much. Probably a little premature, but
I just emailed the plans to Mr. Sharp a couple hours ago.
Okay.
We had a dialogue. I assured Mr. Sharp that we're transparent. I'll share all information with him. He's aware of the fact that we're going to have a development committee meeting internally this week to discuss it, and we'll get input from all the staff members, and we'll move forward on the application. And again, I can't even really speak intelligently of it. I've looked at spent 10 minutes looking at it just so I could, with some intelligence, talk to Mr. Sharp when I called him, but I haven't really jumped in yet. We just got it.
Thank you. Okay, I think we'll move on then to the, did we do the planning and zoning? Yeah, we did the planning
and
zoning. Agenda item number 8 is preliminary site plan review, file number SP1010. Proposed SRB Medical Dental Building, east side of Crooks, south of Waddles, at 3960 Crooks, section 21, currently zoned NN1, neighborhood node, I'm sorry, it's NNI, letter I, neighborhood node I district.
Yes,
Mr. Carl.
Good evening, I'll be giving the report tonight. The applicant tonight is seeking preliminary site plan approval for an office development located on the east side of Crooks, just south of Waddles. The 1.1-acre site is currently improved with a single-family home. The applicant proposes a 9,600-square-foot medical and dental office. The development would include one point of access off Crooks and a shared point of access with the adjacent 7-Eleven. The Planning Commission remembers, the Planning Commission approved the 7-Eleven, Brent, would you say approximately three or so years ago, and it is the is in the form-based district, built to the form-based requirements. As the chairman alluded, the property is zoned neighborhood node, and the property is a permitted use. In our reports, we have identified a number of issues in our review. Our review was sent over to the applicant. They have since subsequently revised our site plan and submitted elevations, colored elevations. We have not had time to review the revised plan. So my report is based on the previous site plan, the one that was concluded in your packet. So I think the applicant tonight can go in a little more detail about how they've addressed our concerns, but let me just highlight our concerns to begin with. Most of our issues are primarily, almost all of our issues are concerned revolves around the stormwater retention pond and the proposed layout of such. The first significant issue is simply the sheer size of the detention pond, and then the fact that due to the size requirements and the depth, they are required to put a fence, a 6-foot-high chain link fence around the detention pond. That is keeping, that's contrary to what the spirit and intent of the neighborhood node district really is trying to promote. Secondly, we note that the detention facility and the existing stormwater plan doesn't utilize any best practices, best management practices. And we think there's some area along the east side of the property and south side as well as where they can incorporate more best management practice. The second significant issue with the detention pond is it limits cross-access to the future to the south. One of the keys to the neighborhood node is interconnectivity between properties and cross-access. As you know, we do have the cross-access to the north to 7-Eleven, and so we're trying to promote the cross-access to the south if and when that property develops. So for those two reasons, we find that the stormwater retention issue should be looked at in greater depth and detail and provided some changes to that moving forward. In regards to the architecture, the applicant did provide floor plans and elevations. The floor plans and elevations were not in color. The elevations were not in color. So we did ask the applicant to provide some architectural details in terms of color rendering or a 3D model to better understand the architectural component of the plan.
I did email it to all the planning commission members.
Okay. So besides those two issues, there's a number of other smaller.
Got the large one. Yeah.
Okay. So those are the two significant issues. Really, we find the stormwater is kind of driving the layout of the site in our concern. There are some minor issues that we feel the property or the developer can easily address. This includes extending the sidewalk south to the property line. He has to widen the approach to Crooks Road. They need to provide the necessary bike parking. They need to add more internal parking lot landscaping. Please, we ask applicants to consider more or different landscape and hardscape material between the building and the Crooks Road to be a little more creative in that design. And also, they do not show any trash enclosure locations or trash enclosure details on the site plan, so we do ask where the trash enclosure is going to be. So that concludes our comments. The applicant, again, is here to address our comments and present, I believe, a revised site plan tonight. But we are asking for postponement on this item until we have a chance to review the revised site plan.
Thank you. Any other questions for Mr. Carlisle? Mr. Hill, that's it.
I noticed the report that on the street trees, it's required to have 8. It decreased because of utilities. It's impossible to plant the trees. What an alternative do they have?
There are utilities, and I think the engineer can explain this in much more detail than I can. There are both overhead and underground utilities that run the entire length of this section of Crooks Road. We did waive street trees for the 7-Eleven located just to the north. The Planning Commission has the right to waive the street tree requirement due to utilities. If you don't waive it, we could try to find some alternative locations within site, but that's up to the purview of the Planning Commission.
Thank you.
Yes, Mr. Tagle.
Is the west facade or face of the building, is that at the utility easement line?
The west? This
west side?
Yes.
Yeah, that.
For the applicant, yes. I will note there, and I put in my report, there were a lot of lines on the site plan. It was hard to really determine what lines were what, so we did ask to clarify in the revised site plan what removes some of the lines for ease of reading.
Any other questions for the consultant? If not, is Mr. Stevens?
Not a question, just a comment. The reason for the cross access, obviously there's valid traffic concerns related to that. It helps to reduce the number of trips onto the major road. But also one of the reasons, the concepts behind a neighborhood node is to have kind of an integrated node. And what we don't want is isolated buildings at the intersection. We want more of a kind of an integrated neighborhood type feel. And without the cross access, that takes away from that possibility.
Is the cross-hatched area down at the south end, that is the retention pond?
Yes.
Yeah, it's not showing up. This is the proposed retention pond somewhere in this location, as was shown as a 6-foot-high chain link fence around here.
Right.
I can let Mr. Hunter speak to this. He's the project engineer, but after the agenda went out, he did provide us with a revised sketch that shows cross access, but it was at the 11th hour. We didn't think it would be right to share that with the Planning Commission,
right?
Because the report is not based on that drawing.
Very good. Mr. Tate.
As far as the traffic engineer, they looked at the site plan.
They have looked at the site plan. They did. They raised all the issues I raised in my report were the issues they raised in terms of traffic. There were no big traffic issues.
Does the left turn lane, northbound left turn lane on Crooks, so you're going northbound on Crooks, there's a center left turn lane, does it come down as far as the access drive, the southern access drive?
I don't know. I will look it up.
It's a continuous left-hand turn lane through there. It keeps going south. If you look at the aerial, Ben,
as well,
I think you can see it there.
The left turn lane.
Yeah.
Center left turn.
Center turn.
That's a center line.
Runs all the way to Big Beaver.
Okay. No further questions. We'll hear from the applicant now. Please state your name and go to the microphone. Assuming you've already signed in.
I have signed in.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you for the opportunity to speak. My name is Dave Hunter. I'm from Professional Engineering Associates. I have Terry Nosen here, the builder for the project, and the owner of the project garage back there, who owns the property. We welcome the chance to talk tonight. We recognize all the comments that the planning department and Mr. Kyle Isle made regarding the project. I think we can take care of all of the comments. We've revised the site plan. We're going to have to work through the detention pond and the sizing. Our goal is not to have a fence around the pond either, so we'll work with staff to get rid of the fence. From an appearance standpoint, we understand their comments. The other comments I think from our standpoint are mostly housekeeping issues that I think we can take care of if Brent agrees with me. We'd like to, either we could work with staff and get an approval tonight. You guys can give us an approval and we could work with staff, or we'd like to come back then maybe in 2 weeks and come back before you if possible with a revised site plan addressing these comments, and we can talk to you again about it. So.
I think Mr. Fagel brought up the issue of the location of the retention pond and the goal to have cross access with the next.
Our plan would have cross access with the pond relocated, a part of the pond relocated, so if there was cross access.
Okay.
We submitted a plan that indicates that. We just ran out of time at the end there. So.
Yeah, I understand. Well, I don't know, any other questions from the planning commissioners? Again, we haven't seen the revised plan yet, so. It's been a long time. I can't remember us ever approving a site plan with 11 issues that are still outstanding, so that's just not what we do. So I would suggest that you come back in 2 weeks and we'll talk about your revised plan.
Okay. And, you know, we do have the building elevation here, a 3D rendering of the west and south facade, if you just want to make sure you're comfortable.
Can I make a suggestion? So the applicant can get some positive feedback tonight, so they can come back in 2 weeks. Can we, one, do we have any comments? Like, have any comments on the proposed elevation, the architecture is one. And the second thing is, Mr. Hunter, if you could quickly walk us through the change, you've done the change of site plan. Could you quickly walk us through some of the conceptual changes of the site plan so that we're comfortable, the planning commission's comfortable with the changes?
So.
Can you pointer?
Yeah. That would be great. Thanks for that.
But you will have to go to the microphone, otherwise it won't pick it up on tape.
So what we've considered doing at this point, is top button right?
It's, you got to play with it a little bit. Mm-hmm. The red.
Got it up in the air somewhere? Oh, there it is.
There it is.
All right. I have one for my cat, but okay. So what we're, our intention is to, we'll have to rework the parking stalls here, have a drive that extends down this way, partly through the existing, where we propose this pond. We'll rework this pond so that we have it, there still be a small pond on this side and then a pond that runs part of the way up here, the west side. We're trying to minimize the size of the pond as much as we can, but we still have to meet the stormwater requirements that the engineering department has at the city. So we're gonna work through that, but we'll eliminate some of the stalls here, run a driveway down here, add additional stalls that we lose. So we try to keep our parking count similar to what we have now, and we want to keep as much of the parking near the building as possible, because the tenants of the building and people coming to the building for treatments and everything else, we'd like to keep the parking close to the building. So we got to rework our plan as much as we can to address that, and provide the cross access for the future to the south, along with providing the easements as part of that process. There's one other comment about the landscaping. We will enhance the plan with calling out all the plant material along the front of the building. I think that was one of Ben's concerns. So.
Yes, Mr. Crowell.
Can you indicate where you put the trash enclosures?
Terry, if you want to help me with that, they believe they don't need a trash enclosure. So either we could show it as a land banked area, but they would prefer not to build a trash enclosure at this point.
Yeah, the 7-Eleven trash enclosure is along the north property line there.
Yeah.
Probably about halfway back, to the west, to the west of their,
the cross access.
So, I don't know if we can work something adequate in that area, but when we reconfigure the parking lot so that we can reconfigure the drainage, I think that other opportunities will appear, and some that are there today may disappear. But if it's necessary to have it.
Yeah, I mean, if we, we'll have it. If it's necessary to have it, it'll probably be up in this corner of the mm-hmm. of the site.
So
there's no requirement that a business have a trash enclosure. There is a requirement, if they do have a trash enclosure, that it be screened and gated so that it's aesthetically pleasing. It is theoretically possible for this business to keep and dispose of their garbage without having any, garbage outside and whatnot. But if they do have outside garbage, they're gonna have to enclose it.
Right. Well, I did notice that this building is not leased or anything yet. There was extra space to be leased, is that correct?
Yeah, there's
couple stories.
Spatra's wife is a practicing dentist in the city of Troy right now, the top of Troy building. And she's going to be the principal original tenant, and then once we have some sense of the approval of the project, then we'll seek some additional tenants to fill it. It'll be a multi-tenant building.
Thank you. Mr. Hudson.
Mr. Chairman, you've been before us many times, and I think you know our preference is the last thing we'd like to see in these sites is a detention pond. They were really into water features, bioswales, and this sort of thing. So if you could direct your attention in that direction, well, I think it'd meet with some favor with us.
We'll do everything we can.
I think that was the gist of the real rough draft of the revised plans he provided today to staff and to me to just take a first look at.
Mr. Nelson and I have been going back and forth trying to figure out the most cost-effective way and best-looking improvement for the project. So,
how about the parking itself? Is there a chance that could be permeable?
I'd love to do permeable parking, but with the soil conditions here, we're still fighting the silty clay soil, and it just gets to be.
It's not going to go anywhere.
I'd love to do that, but it would be challenging.
Thank you. Question, Craig.
If they don't have a trash enclosure, do they just set out garbage cans all day long?
No.
How does that work?
Acceptable. What they would have to do is they'd have to come up contract with a company to pick up and dispose of the garbage without it being an eyesore. Which some businesses do, especially it's a lot easier. Obviously, with a restaurant business or a market where you've got a lot of produce, it's more difficult. When you have, depending on how much waste, depending on what the volume and the type of waste, it's a lot easier when it's an office versus food.
Mr. Tagle.
A couple of things. One, to follow up on what Tom just said, I guess I'd like to know what the plan is if you don't have a trash enclosure with a multi-tenant building. Where do you store the trash? Is this part of the lease agreement for the tenants that they have to comply with whatever the plan is? I don't know if there's anyone here from that could answer an architectural question, but I look at the floor plan and the entry points to the building, and I'm not sure, there's no north arrow on the plan. So I'm not sure, but if that plan is oriented so that the dental office is on the east side, which would be closest to the parking, if that's the primary tenant, I assume that would be the correct orientation. You've got a vestibule on the north side, and I don't even see a parking lot or a sidewalk over there to get in.
Yeah, actually, the dental clinic is on the west side.
So they're facing Crooks.
They're facing Crooks.
And the parking is on the east side.
And the parking is on the south and the east.
The north arrow would be pointing to the right.
Yes.
We don't prefer that. So if your revised plan, please get the arrow to the north. That's typically what architects do.
Well, I guess my point is the site plan and the building plan just doesn't seem to really work real well. I mean, where the points of entry are and how the lease spaces are divided up.
Well, the Crooks Road points of entry, frankly, are there for convenience of pedestrian traffic, but really, I think we're still in even though it's a neighborhood node, it's not a neighborhood where people are going to be coming and going by foot yet. So our focus is on the one entrance with the common hallway that's on the east side of the building and the entrance on the south side of the building because that's what's served by parking. But we're providing for entrances to the sidewalk to the extent that they're feasible and like for staff to leave that way and walk to 7-Eleven or something like that, it's fine. But we don't feel realistically people would come and go along Crooks Road if they're coming for an appointment to one of these facilities.
How about bikers?
Bikers could,
yes.
And I saw one of the things was we have to provide some bike rack or whatever. I think we can certainly
do that.
is it the plan to make this a medical building?
Primarily, yeah. Medical dental.
Well, again, I guess I just question the convenience of some of these entry points to where the parking is. You know, come mid-January, if I've got to park in the far corner of the lot and I want to go to that northern door on Crooks Road, that's a long walk.
Yeah, that's actually the southern, this door here, John, is the southern door.
Correct, but if I wanted to go to this suite,
okay,
and I'm parking back here, or even, well, I guess this corridor.
This corridor would get you which way is north.
There's no arrow. Which way is north on this drawing?
To the right.
Right?
Yeah. So there's, as the site plan sits right now, there's parking along the bottom, which would be the east facing wall, mm-hmm. and there's parking along the left-hand side.
Right. As far as the building appearance on the outside, what kind of materials? I know you show a brick material. Is it real brick?
Yeah.
I mean, it's a standard modular brick instead of like a face brick or anything like that.
A stick-on type
yeah.
brick?
No.
I certainly hope not.
We do too.
Yeah. They should have a lot of trees. It should look really nice.
In the limestone panels, is that stucco or is that real limestone?
No, it would be either real limestone or a cast stone product. It's like limestone, but a thick, real product, again, not a laminate, mm-hmm. or certainly not a dry bed. We actually modeled this building. There's a similar building on Long Lake and Telegraph. There's a Max Brook Realtor building. So if you're in that neighborhood, drive by, it's got a very similar appearance, although I think ours is a little nicer to lower and sweeter looking.
Mr.
Sapp, the material combination is there.
I guess, to Dave, I'd ask, just look at the landscaping in front of the building,
sure.
see if you can do something, and even, you know, maybe something a little bit more vertical than the depiction here.
Yeah. Well, this is an artist rendering, and he didn't really attempt to.
Well, we're just trying to give you some feedback.
Yeah, I understand. Yeah. And we, you know, we can certainly do that.
Yeah, thank you.
Certainly.
Mr. Krebs.
Back to the architecture, that whole facade on Crooks, are those all full glass panels, or are those clear right into the office?
They're full glass panels that in the evening would be open, you know, to the office. They do window cover.
I'm sorry, I can't hear you. You got to speak up
yeah,
loud.
There would be, they're full glass. Part of the reason they're full glass is because under the ordinance, we're required to have that percentage of glass on the front of the building. And I think we're within the percentage required. Frankly, if you said we'd rather see that elevation with a wainscot of brick on it or something, you know, and more landscaping, in front of it, we could do that. We're flexible. We put this on to meet the ordinance requirement. It'd probably be, we haven't picked the materials yet, but it would probably be somewhat of a slightly reflective glass or tinted glass as opposed to a clear glass. It's typical what we do on these types of buildings. You know, the aluminum frames, very clean looking.
Mr. Tickle.
You may want to consider some type of sunscreen or shading. Because with tall pieces of glass, even if you're using a reflective glass,
mm-hmm.
it comes to the afternoon sun. It's
the west sun is,
yeah. And plus, it would give you a little bit more depth on that elevation. It's fairly flat right now.
Mm-hmm.
That would be a consideration to your advantage. Okay.
Any other concerns or comments, questions?
No, I think there's been some really constructive feedback provided related to the building, the landscaping, the detention. I think if it sounds like, Mr. Chairman, you're leaning towards postponement for 2 weeks to give the opportunity to update.
Right. Until such time as the issues raised in this meeting, as well as staff issues.
They've got an engineer who works very quickly and very proficiently, so I'm confident that we can have revised plans back to us in a timely manner.
Can I have, please have a resolution to that effect, Mr. Kratt?
I'll move that we postpone this issue for 2 weeks.
Until such time as the client can address the issues. Yeah, I don't think we need to postpone it to a date certain. It's more an action that we want them to have.
Well, I was thinking that that engineer was going to get it done.
I'm going back to the office tonight.
You may be here at 8 o'clock tomorrow morning. Okay, well, thank you very much. There's a motion for Mr. Kratt and a second, Mr. Tagle. Any other comments regarding the resolution? If not, the roll call, please.
Mr. Faison?
Yes.
Mr. Hudson?
Yes.
Mr. Krantz?
Yes.
Ms. Kupa?
Yes.
Mr. Tagle?
Yes.
Mr. Abahedian?
Yes.
Ms. Cruz?
Yes.
Mr. Edmonds?
And yes. Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for your input tonight. Thank you, everybody.
Thanks, Dave.
Thank you.
Next item is number 9, the master plan update. Who wants to kick this off?
Ben's going to lead the discussion, but I promised him I would chime in ad nauseum throughout the presentation.
So. You reserve the right to interrupt.
Yes.
Okay.
In fact, if I don't interrupt him frequently, he will kick me.
I just want to, not an excuse, but an explanation. I feel a little under the weather, so if I'm less enthusiastic than normal, it's not because of lack of enthusiasm for this project. It's other reasons. We're finally at this point. It's been a long road to get here, but I'm glad and proud to present what we think is the final draft, still draft, of the master plan updates for discussion. A lot of Plannig Commission wasn't even on the Plannig Commission at the time when we started this, and for those who have trouble remembering like I do, when we started this project, we really were focusing on very specific parts of the master plan. The first thing we were looking at was to update the demographics. The plan was adopted in 2008. Since that time, the 2010 census has come out, and so the demographics obviously are much more reflective of the actual numbers than what the 2008 plan shows. So that was a focus. The second focus was on housing priorities. We've heard from many of the constituents in the community that they wanted us to look at different housing options in the community. And those were all wrapped up into Chapter 8, which is an existing chapter in the ordinance. The other thing that we had discussed and focused on was doing more targeted special area plans for some of the targeted areas in the community. And we really started out with 3, which is Maple Road, North Troy, and Rochester Road. However, in the process of this planning process, some issues on Big Beaver came into play, especially pedestrian issues along and across Big Beaver. So we rolled that special area plan also into the master plan.
We did something similar in 2008 when we rolled the Big Beaver corridor study into the master plan.
And lastly, we have and will update all other relevant outdated information in the whole plan itself moving forward. So I think I confused everyone last week by how I, or 2 weeks ago, when I approached the issue of appendix versus supplement versus whatever term you want to use.
Confused.
Well, I'm easily apt to confusing people.
When he said the word appendix, everyone on the outside of the table went like this.
So this is how we propose to do the updated master plan. Essentially, Chapters 1 through 7 will remain as is. We will update those to take out outdated information, but the core of that will remain as is. Chapter 8, which is the people, that's the demographic and housing, it will be, I use the term 2, it will be more replaced with what that chapter is. Chapter 9 is the land patterns. That will not change. That is what it, that is, it will remain as is. We have included a new Chapter 10, which is the special area plan, which are the 4 plans that we have shown. And then lastly, the last chapter is implementation. That also will be updated to reflect mostly 10 and 8 moving forward. So this will be part of the master plan. It's not an appendix. It's some additional chapters and some revisions to the existing chapter of the master plan. So that's why tonight we didn't send out the 200-page master plan in addition to what the changes are. We'll roll that all in together. We really want to focus on the significant changes that we were talking about.
So I have a quick, brief update on every single chapter of the plan. I can go as fast or as slow as the Planning Commission desires, but I'm going to try to go faster, and if there's questions, please stop me. So after all the research of the census data and talking to constituents and the engagement, some of the housing demographic findings we found, it's not surprising anyone. Troy is aging, Troy is diversifying, and Troy is experiencing changing preferences, preferably or particularly in housing preferences. So just a little background. The blue graph is the under 18 population. The red bars are the over 65 population. As you can see, the under 18 is slowly dropping in terms of pure numbers, but the over 65 population is greatly increasing in numbers. So by 2040, for the first time in Troy's history, the first time in the state's history, and then really the first time in the country's history, there'll be more seniors than people under age of 18 within our population. In addition to that, household types are also changing. In 2060, almost 50% of the households had children. However, starting in 2010 all the way to 2040, they project that less than 30% of the households will have children. This is due to a myriad of factors such as more seniors, people are waiting longer to have children, and more couples are not having children. So all those factors add up into why there are less children in the household. In addition to that, households with only one person is also significantly increasing. Similar reasons, people are not having children or waiting to have children. There are more seniors, etc. So why does this matter, and what does this really mean? Oh, last thing to mention too is Troy is diversifying in terms of demographics and of race. The white population has decreased by almost 8% from 2000 to 2010, and a significant increase in the Asian population in that time frame too. So all this means is that we are having more seniors, less households with children, smaller households in terms of numbers, but our housing type doesn't necessarily reflect that. We have 72% of our housing stock is single-family residential. And these numbers are gonna even get more skewed in the future with this more senior population. So what that essentially means is that Troy's housing stock really is not representative of the anticipated future population. I think we all recognize that Troy is a single-family residential community. Its strength is in the single-family residential stock. I don't think it's a goal or policy of the city to get away from the strength of single-family neighborhoods, but I think it is a policy to provide for alternative and more housing options to address the whole scope of the life continuum for both millennials, younger generation, all the way up to the senior and older populations. So what are our priorities? We heard this very strong and clear in all our outreach and engagement opportunities was focus on aging in places and focus on what we deem or what is deemed as the missing middle. I'll get into that real quickly. But aging in places simply is the concept of integrating housing, social engagement, and well-being into one community. So you don't have to have three separate locations for all of those. They're more integrated into one location. It's more of a holistic lifestyle for the aging population rather than simply putting them in a senior living facility and kind of that's where they are, but try to integrate them more into the community. In terms of the missing middle, this is a pretty popular term you'll hear on. There's a lot of topic at the actual conference. And these are in the range a little bit denser or more housing than a detached single family, so starting with a duplex or attached single family, going all the way up to apartment buildings. And so these are trying to hit the middle housing market. And the characteristic of this is a much more walkable environment. It's got transitional density, so your typical single family residential neighborhood might be one unit to an acre, two units to an acre, three units to an acre. This is talking about 5 units to an acre, 10 units to an acre. So a little bit more density, but not overly dense like the 60 or 70 units to an acre that we started to experience in other locations. Smaller, well-designed units, these are still valuable and expensive housing stock, but they're not, they're a little bit smaller, catering towards the smaller families. And lastly, de-emphasizing the parking, having parking more integrated into the developments rather than just standalone parking lots.
They also mean they've got they're typically of pretty very high quality. There's not a trade-off on or loss of quality. If anyone's bored tonight at home, search, go on online, your favorite search engine, and put in the term missing middle. There's a website dedicated to this concept that's fantastic. It's got a lot of great information, great visuals.
So the target locations in Troy that we're talking about for missing middle are those special area plans that we talked about. It's neighborhood nodes, it's Maple Road, it's Big Beaver when it's part of mixed-use development, and it's Rochester Road. These are just some architectural examples of the missing middle. As you can see, they're fairly high quality. It ranged everything from this is actually a duplex, a attached duplex, to a fourplex, to apartment styles, to this is Mr. Evans' favorite. This is a live work unit where you have office or commercial on the front and upper story residential.
Which we're still looking for.
It's our white whale, isn't it? And that leads us to our special area plans. These, the missing middle really was a focus of our special area plans. Again, there were four different areas we were looking at, different focuses of study for each one, but a lot of the commonality issues that were addressed in the engagement were reflected in these special area plans. So all the special area plans, except for Big Beaver, have the same layout. We have a background and introduction explaining why we're doing this. There's a vision statement for each of those. There's existing conditions and property data. We actually go into a lot of market data and economic data in that area. And then they're more action oriented. So we have priorities, we have strategies, and then we have action. We have an action for every strategy and a strategy for every priority. And lastly, we have implementation. Very focused on actually implementing this. For these special area plans, we did a lot of public engagement over the course of a long time. We didn't do the traditional open house or large community-wide visioning exercise, but that was done as part of the 2008 master plan. What we truly tried to focus on was more specific targeted outreach and groups. The Planning Commission, remember, we held a real estate forum approximately a little over a year ago. It was very well attended. There were over 70 members of the community as well as market and real estate experts to lend their vision. They really talked on the four areas and gave us insight to four areas. We had the Move Across Troy Symposium, which was focused on access and pedestrian across and along Big Beaver. We had a high school forum, which we invited 20 senior or high school students in Troy. Each of them was much more articulate and well-spoken and brighter than Brent and I.
Come on.
We walked away very impressed with and great insight, and it was really, really impressive to do that.
And very hopeful for the future of the country, too.
Yeah.
Hopefully they'll all stay.
Well, you'll see in the findings what they said on that one. We had a neighborhood association forum. We invite all the neighborhood association presidents to talk about neighborhood-specific issues. And lastly, we had the Boomer and Shaker Forum, which was targeted towards the Asian population in Troy. For obviously there were some different findings from each of the different groups we talked to, but there are really some collective findings that we really received as this. First is that we really do need to look at density, and density really only in strategic locations. We do want to preserve our existing single-family residential neighborhoods, but there are locations that we really should be looking at increased density and trying to address that missing middle. Part of that was to provide more housing options, again, protect existing single-family residential neighborhoods. These two came out actually more, the transportation options and walkable locations from the senior forum than anything else that we talked about. They want to walk to places. They want to have options. A lot of them noted that they can drive now, but they're very scared of what's going to happen when they can't drive, and they might have to move out of Troy because they can't get their daily needs if they can't drive in Troy. So that was a target of the discussion, was providing more transportation options and walkable locations to get their daily needs. So real quickly, I'll go over each plan in a little bit of detail. Rochester Road, the vision of Rochester Road, the 2008 vision really talked about a green infrastructure and landscaping. We're not getting away from that concept, but we really want to get back to the point of it's a retail commercial corridor, and it should be reflective of that. And but we want to make it a more pedestrian-friendly and neighborhood-oriented commercial corridor. One thing we've seen since the 2008 and subsequently the update to the zoning ordinance is that we do need to also maintain and protect adjacent property owners, single-family property owners, so we do need to focus on the buffer between those.
ones too. So the vision statement tries to kind of hit those core concepts. There were three priorities that came out of the Rochester Road Plan. The first was to enhance the image and identity through both private investment as well as public-private partnerships, to improve access management, and lastly, to preserve adjacent residential character and encourage compatible development. So if you'll see, the first one was engage the image. I'll go into each of the priorities with the strategies for each one of these. So engage the image and identity through private investments and public-private partnerships. There was discussion about developing design guidelines. Plannig Commission members, we have design guidelines for Big Beaver. We also have them for the neighborhood node and Maple Road as well. As part of the zoning ordinance, update them to include design guidelines. Establish a building improvement program, facade program, or something of that nature to just get higher quality building and rehab of existing facilities out there. Coordinate streetscape improvements. This can either be done as a corridor-wide initiative or develop a streetscape program so as development occurs, we get the streetscape at that time of development. But just have some coordination where we have similar features such as pedestrian lighting and benches and a nice decorative wall, etc. So there's some consistency of development. And lastly, still try to encourage innovative stormwater management along the corridor. The second priority was to improve access management. The strategy for that, there was a very detailed study done on Rochester Road all the way from...
involved five or six communities along.
Yes, so very detailed, but implement that plan because it had a lot of detail in terms of dealing with access management along Rochester Road. Support a lot consolidation. Oftentimes there are very small, shallow lots that make it difficult to have access management, coordinated access management. You start consolidating lots, you can do much more of that as well. And then lastly, require consistent building placement and parking location so you can deal with some of the access management issues. And lastly, the strategy was to preserve adjacent residential character and encourage compatible development. This mostly spoke to ensure an adequate rear yard setback and landscape buffer to protect the new development we hope to see on Rochester Road with the existing established residential neighborhoods that abut it. Any questions on it? I'll stop here. Any questions on Rochester Road? The plan's going into much more detail.
Mr. Tagle.
Excuse me, height of new construction or buildings on Rochester Road to support your last quote as far as distance or setbacks versus height?
Yes, we didn't get into the issue in terms of establishing a exact height. I think that's something that we could do with the zoning ordinance, and that's something that actually we've raised with the Planning Commission. We want to bring that back to amend the zoning ordinance to address that issue.
Okay. Well, I mean, it may be worth at least mentioning here as a general statement, because we're not getting into it's a 50-foot setback or 75, but height and setback.
A rational relationship between height and setback.
Mr. Crutt.
I just wondered... what kind of access are we providing on this? I love everything about it. I love the streetscape, all the concepts of creating an identity to this pretty random visual clutter of Rochester Road. But one element I would like to see in there somehow is bike trail pathways. We're struggling with that. I'm on the Trails Committee, and every time we look at a new street development, we're looking actually more to Livernois because there's more availability of creating something on Livernois for north-south, but we need a north-south for bikes. Is there any opportunity for bikes on this? It looks pretty tight right now.
There's been a lot of investment along Rochester Road. I want to have a discussion with our traffic engineer on this issue because I know there's been a lot of investment and there was an opportunity to take that step not that long ago, and it wasn't taken. So I don't know if...
Yeah, because of this new boulevard.
Exactly.
Yeah. Okay, I understand that.
Recent investment.
Well, maybe we could look to Livernois to create some kind of a north-south for the bikers.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Maybe just a thought, and I don't know, maybe it's been discussed, but if we're having a setback in the rear property line, maybe that setback could incorporate some vertical or some... bike paths or walking paths back there as part of the green space.
And the rear property along
mm-hmm.
that line?
Mm-hmm. Interesting.
I think that's worth considering. Yeah.
Nice idea, Ken.
You just earned your keep.
Yeah. I was going to say something obnoxious like architects do have.
They do have value, yeah.
I was waiting for someone.
Alive here.
I was waiting for someone to point out the Cobra head lights on Rochester Road, designed for freeways, but no one did.
Yeah. Well, I noticed even in your illustrations, you had much more pedestrian
yes.
scale. I think that certainly should be a goal. You have to have more lights, a greater number of lights if you go to the pedestrian scale lighting along the sides of the road? Or do you have to, is the number still the same but just at a lower?
Well, you can still have very, very intense lights that are lower scale, but the idea is to, when you go higher, you have to have more intense, you still soften them.
Yes, Mr. Pesa.
I was just curious, when you talk about the Rochester Road District going forward to this, what's the extension? It's a lot of the drawings seem to be between Big Beaver and Waddles. I was wondering if that was the extent of it or was it beyond that?
That was the primary extent. Was it?
I think it was.
Okay. I was just asking for clarification.
Yeah.
And the reason it was, it was to Waddles. The reason is because that's the primary commercial section. When you get north of that, there's a scattering of
right.
commercial, but it's mostly multifamily, and then we start getting into the neighborhood nodes,
okay.
which we address, other parts of the plan. So really we're talking about the main mile of commercial development between Big Beaver and Waddles.
Thank you.
At the time we first began the discussion, that was, I think that issue came up.
It did.
And we said why we probably should limit it, at least for the time being, to the 2 mile area then. Okay.
So moving on to Maple Grove, this obviously was another area that we at Planning Commission had a lot of input and a lot of discussion on, and Maple Road's kind of, there's been a lot less focus on Maple Road in the past in Troy's history than there is, for example, on Big Beaver or some of the other corridors. So Maple Road really has been short-shifted in terms of planning resources. So we really dove into Maple Road here with the idea is that we're going to be less focused on the land use and more focused on quality design and development. Maple Road includes an eclectic mix of different zoning districts. We have the IB, which is some have deemed the Wild West, where kind of anything goes in terms of land uses. We've got Maple Road zoning there. You've got the planned vehicle district there. You have multifamily districts. You have a whole bunch of mixed districts. So it's hard to focus from a planning perspective on a land use. Let's more focus on just ensuring that we have good quality design on Maple Road. But we also want to realize that there's really still the warehousing, light industrial, entrepreneurial area really of the city. And we do also want to focus in terms of we maintain that spirit of Maple Road as well. So there were three priorities as well as for Maple Road. The first was to generate investment and development at the development nodes. The development nodes are the intersections of Maple Road and the major mile corridor. Encourage entrepreneurialism and redevelopment, specifically mostly a lot in these smaller industrial kind of nodes that kind of line both north and south along the corridor. And lastly, we would want to recognize that there is still a significant area that's in between these development nodes, and we want to strengthen and enhance the segments between these major mile intersections. So in terms of generating investment at development nodes,
excuse me.
The first was to encourage high-quality commercial mixed-use development at the intersections, find ways to engage the surrounding residential neighborhoods through linkages, mostly pedestrian connections. And lastly, to implement this would be to incentivize development through zoning. Find development changes, zoning changes to incentivize or require the type of development that we really want at these nodes. Increase height, increase density, whatever we think we can achieve to get the kind of development that we're really looking for in this area. Encourage entrepreneurialism and redevelopment. It's kind of interesting, and Brent, you can speak to this a little more. There have been little clusters throughout the Maple Road of unique industries. For example, Industrial Row has a lot of different home warehousing types of uses, et cetera. So there's little clusters of different kind of cottage industries that have kind of developed along Maple Road. So we want to encourage that and find ways to incentivize, you know.
An opportunity for more of that. I mean, I've often thought there's opportunity for something like you could have like a sports-themed subdivision where you've got inline skating and, you know, a gym and racquetball and all these types of businesses. Similarly type theme, you could share parking, you could become kind of a place. I think Ben hit the nail on the head when he talks about Industrial Row. It's definitely taking on a design flavor.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, those of us on the Sustainable Development Review Committee, last month we had a project where CIOT has purchased two buildings and they're moving into that building, and there's a number of uses that are kind of building on one another in along Industrial Row. And just that type of thinking, there's more opportunity for that in this area.
And the last thing in terms of in this strategy to remember is that the existing smart zone automation alley is within this district, so there's definitely location and financial incentive to be in this area, especially with automation alley. So we want to leverage that partnership. And the Planning Commission didn't have much role in it, but the LDFA for the city was extended another 15 years with the state. So again, adding more life and vitality to the smart zone. And lastly, we don't want to forget these segments in between the major mile intersections. We want to identify alternative value. Essentially, how can what's the market for these kind of these properties that have been languishing for a little while? We've got to find some alternative value for them. Whether that's more multifamily housing, more warehousing type uses, we should try to find some value for those. Implement zoning amendments to permit more flexibility. The ordinance is pretty flexible in the IB zoning district. It's a little bit less flexible in the Maple Road district, which lines the corridor, so maybe we need to look at more flexibility in that zoning district moving forward.
It's flexible in terms of use, but not so flexible in terms of design. And that's something that I think we need to look at. Place on the building and the parking, it's not Big Beaver. I think we're a little bit heavy-handed in hindsight, a little bit heavy-handed with the design requirements in 2008. I think we should probably consider loosening on some of those. But I think from a use perspective, the Maple Road District is very, very inclusive.
Next, improve pedestrian access. You know, Maple Road, especially to the south, is lined with residential. It's very hard to get from the residential up into and onto the corridor. And lastly, Maple Road has some of the similar issues that we have with Big Beaver in terms of crossing. It's just not easy or friendly to cross. And there's really, you know, there's a physical barrier between north and south Maple Road. Any questions?
Any questions on that issue?
Just one thing. I liked how across from the MGR, you were looking at forward, looking at housing there. I think it's wonderful. That would add a lot to that strip.
Yeah, that's a really, it's hard to see from these pictures.
That's a Livernois note. Yeah,
so it's hard to see here, but that little strip that's zoned Maple Road, and it's very shallow, and it's very hard to really redevelop for commercial purposes. So one of the ideas that's been floated is to kind of turn this area into more multifamily or various types of uses to kind of address some of the parcel issues in that area. So being a little more creative in terms of the uses for this area.
Yeah. I like that part of the plan.
Thank you. Any other questions on Maple Road?
Okay.
Special area plan in this format was North Troy. This was actually the first one we looked at. And this is not necessarily to change the character as more of an employment opportunity area, but add more amenities to the area. One of the things we talked about and heard from many people that actually work in the area was you drive to your office and you get out of your car, go to your office building, leave to go to lunch. You have to either drive down to Big Beaver or you have to drive to Rochester Road. There's just not a lot of amenities and services within the area. You also have a pretty high population in the surrounding area that really don't utilize the area. The residents that are adjacent to it don't utilize North Troy for anything. This pretty much seems to be a more of a commute in and commute out type of environment and location. So providing more amenities to the people that work there and live in the proximity to it. So the priorities were to provide a compatible environment mix of use,
improve multiple circulation and safety within the in the area, as well as inspire placemaking to create a more lively place. So what we talked about is provide a provider mixed use. And Brent, can you speak to real quickly, the zoning for this area was only permitted office and didn't allow for other types of uses, correct?
That's correct. There was a rezoning about 20 years ago to allow that the retail concentration. There's a Starbucks and there's a sushi place and a sub shop, and that was referred to internally as the grand experiment, because I think there was some thought that it was going to fail in that location. Anyone who's been there between the hours of 11:30 and 1:30 is wildly successful. It's difficult to find a parking spot, and I think that only goes to support our belief, and I think when we talked about this a few months ago, your belief that more amenities here would be supported and would help to increase, improve value of these properties.
So what this map shows, all the whites are the existing buildings. And you can see there's just a lot of parking, underutilized space, etc. What the red and the yellow indicate are just infill of new buildings, new uses to be more efficient in terms of land use. The yellows we're showing is residential. This would mirror the residential across Northfield Parkway. And then the yellow here is a little bit higher, multifamily, kind of in the core of the area. And the red are commercial and or service oriented businesses, just to kind of line the street and give more presence to that area. Another thought was, and this is actually a thought Mr. Krent led, was to really create a community gathering space kind of in the central core of the area to kind of encourage, have events in it, be a central gathering place, just kind of be a community focus for the neighborhood. So that concept is also in the plan. We actually show, I think, maybe not. This kind of is a kind of a conceptual model of what the community gathering space could look like. The second was to improve multimodal and circulation. We went back and forth with the city engineering department on this one. It's our feeling from a planning perspective that the roads and the road system is overbuilt, over-engineered. And so we are talking about doing some road diets, which is basically reducing the number of lanes on a road to encourage more multimodal transportation. So you take four lanes, make it down to three lanes, and put in a bike path or a walking trail or something like that, to just reduce the actual physical size of the road and amount of travel.
And with all those office buildings, there's a lot of people in them that really, I think, would welcome that type of amenity.
That's true, but then there was other also comments that maybe between 4:30 and 4:45 it wouldn't be so welcome. You had thousands of people exiting at the same time. That was one of the comments that we received.
Well, can there be some flexibility in that? Say, you know, the bike lanes are not there during those kind of hours.
Well, it's a permanent solution. So,
yeah, but it's paint. You
know? Well, this is just a planning document. We haven't gotten to the actual engineering, so that there could be some discussion when we move forward with the actual implementation.
Don't a lot of those office buildings stagger their hours when people are released to in those areas?
Some of them do.
Or you can encourage that anyway, too.
Mr. Chairman, I think one of the issues here is that a lot of the people that populate those buildings don't live here. So at 5 o'clock, if they want to get on that freeway and head north or south or north on Crooks, I mean, it's like a parking lot on those streets.
Right.
So the bike paths would serve residents that if we created those community areas.
Yes.
But good during point. Certain hours of the day, it's you don't want to be on a bike.
Similar issues in many of our other special area plans, which is increased pedestrian accessibility, especially pedestrian mid-block crossings. John, is this your office right here?
Yes.
And there, the Red Robin and that.
Mm-hmm.
It's very difficult to cross.
Oh yeah. I mean, the only saving grace at anywhere from 11:30 to 12 The traffic isn't that heavy on Corporate Drive. Mm-hmm. But otherwise, yeah, I mean, cars go pretty fast down there. I mean, you have to be alert.
And likewise, it's very difficult to cross Crooks Road here, too. So just including some pedestrian mid-block crossings along in these sections to improve crossing pedestrians. And lastly, what you can see by the green buffering is just providing more landscape buffers and setbacks along to make it a little more aesthetically pleasing along Crooks Road. Lastly, is to inspire placemaking to create a more lively place. There's no, sometimes when you go up there, there's no there. There's no presence, there's no sense of a place there. And so one of the ideas we talked about was actually creating an identity through gateways and wayfinding within the area. Second was to facilitate a health and wellness initiative. We did speak to a lot of people who actually work there. A lot of them during lunchtime take walks, walking in the area. So let's make a program out of it. Let's, community walks there or something like that in the area.
You know, if I could just add to that, there is such an abundance of parking in there. Now, in the complex where our office is, I mean, they did a wonderful job of not taking down a lot of trees, and you'll just see people walking in the parking lots just because they're real close to nature, you know, out there. You know, maybe there could be something even done in those areas because we don't need all that parking. But you've got a lot of the natural environment already there. I mean, they're mature trees.
And these concepts will be done in part and parcel with adding more amenities, more commercial, more places to spend money and hang out, and as well as more residential. So it's really kind of a puzzle. This is just one piece of the puzzle for making that area more of a place. That's the key word, I think, is right now. It has a feel. A lot of times it's a place where you drive there at 8 o'clock in the morning and you get in your car at 5 o'clock, you leave, and that you're good for the next until tomorrow morning. But this is making more of a 24-hour place, more of a vibrant, real place.
It was amazing. The landlord several years ago, when times were better, a number of years ago, he would have a picnic on a Friday afternoon or something, and it's amazing how many people came out for that. And it was just that added that vitality to the space. And where otherwise, it's just like you said, you're in and out.
Well, and we even threw in the plan. It goes back to the Encourage Creative program, and one of the ideas was have a food truck Friday.
Yeah,
a bunch of food trucks out there. Just to bring more people out into the area. So
have those organized activities within the Timberland buildings kind of died down then?
Yeah. When the occupancy rates went down, income went down, so yes. the activities.
Is there any sign of them coming back?
Not really, not yet.
Thank you. Okay. Mr. Brett.
That Timberland office building complex, I think is a wonderful, wonderful environment. I would like to see that as the seed for the rest of that whole north area. So we've got excess parking. Why don't we make some of those that excess parking into tree-lined bike paths or walking paths or exercise paths and make some kind of a circle so that people have, they can like mile markers, they know how far they're going to go, you know, make it a real activity as opposed to just you know, a happenstance thing. Actually create a wellness trail.
It's hard to see on this, Tom, but actually in the plan, page 88, all these green areas are actually starting to promote more wooded areas and more
nice
landscaping, kind of returning back to be similar to what you're talking about.
And then you create a destination point too, like for a gathering, for a picnic, maybe at, you know, one of those things I suggested months ago. An activity area. So that maybe, I know near my office building where I am in Southfield, the city puts on, I think it's a city-county combined thing, but the three summer months, July, August, September, they bring out a band shelter thing, and they bring in five or six of, you know, you talk about trucked lunches. These are really great ones, like, you know, these super barbecue pit guys and, you know, all kind of great. It's not just, you know, sandwiches off a truck. It's really wild stuff. You know, you can see it at a fair. And create that so that they know every July, August, September, at whatever central zone we're going to have entertainment, we're going to have food, people come out of the offices. It's just a neat thing to have.
The
that concludes North Troy.
Big Beaver was a little bit different. It wasn't like the other three. This was really focused on a very, very focused specific issue that was pedestrian crossing along in between Big Beaver. We were actually not the lead consultant on this project. The city brought in a gentleman by the name of Mark DeLaverne from Sam Schwartz Engineering, who actually wrote the Chicago pedestrian plan. And he worked with the city on developing the Big Beaver pedestrian plan, for lack of a better term. It's very detailed. I'm just simply going to go over the highlights of what that plan really is. But the outline of the plan was, we talked about an executive summary. He really does study the existing conditions. He gives the city some case studies to consider other communities that have addressed. You know, it's not too often a community thinks about pedestrian issues along a 200-foot long, you know, wide right-of-way road with 10 lanes or something of that nature that goes 45 miles an hour. It's a complex issue. But he does have some case studies. He offers a number of what he calls a toolbox, and these are just kind of ideas to think about. And then he gets into implementing the toolbox through recommendations. And he does, what he does is the start now, which is like due tomorrow, the short term, which is 5 to 10 years, and the long term, which is 10 years out. The do now, the first one was to focus initial efforts for a crossing at the Automation Alley Smart Zone area. This is Troy Sports is up here. There's a Starbucks and some other businesses in this location.
Joe Cool's.
And the reason why this was chosen was two reasons. One, it was a little bit easier engineering-wise to actually figure out the engineering to get this in place. But second, also, there's money for it because it's located within the smart zone. Good news is if this is going through engineering drawings, and either complete or very close to complete, so this will be implemented hopefully very shortly. I don't know if we have a date yet, but.
And we can present, when it's completed, we'll present to the Planning Commission. Another incentive for making this a high priority is Altair at the bottom.
Right.
It's very, very motivated to see this happen. We call it the 100-yard dash for your life when you cross that. Because if you've got limited time for lunch, like all of us do, you don't want to have to walk all the way down to the crossing, cross, and all the way back, where you've got that really tempting, 204-foot right-of-way you have to cross at very high risk of your life.
I remember that gentleman saying that they do have a significant number of employees that actually do make that 100-yard dash right now. And I think it is imperative that we get something like this going, because it's a health and safety issue.
They've also got, in this particular business, and a lot of businesses are the same, they have employees come from another country, another continent,
right.
And they work here for weeks or months at a time. They can't drive as much, they're not as familiar with the area, so they want to be able to walk, and they want to be able to walk for food and for coffee and whatnot, so they'll do this walk every day, and it's dangerous. And we want this business to succeed, we want all businesses along Big Beaver, and everywhere in the city to succeed, so this is a really important first step. When this isn't planned and then constructed, we'll take lessons we learned from this. I assume it's going to be very well designed, but we'll study it. And if it works perfectly, we'll implement it in other places. If it needs to be tweaked, we'll learn from that.
Assuming something like this is not prohibitively cost.
Of the three priority areas, this is the least complicated and the least expensive.
Just need to do it.
What about the food trucks for Automation Alley, that area? If you can do it up in North Troy, why can't they do it up by Automation Alley?
It could be done here. Just need someone to lead.
Yeah.
The second thing to do now is to do more outreach, work with the community, work with the businesses, develop a website and graphics and marketing materials to kind of address, and then also set some goals for outreach. You've got more specifics about what the outreach programs are, but really start doing some of this outreach now. Short term, again, 0 to 5 years. The next one will be to establish the nodes along Big Beaver, and this includes the Civic Center Drive node. This is actually a pedestrian crossing here at City Hall campus or the Marriott.
or DMC, somewhere in this node, to get across to the Friday's property or the office property across the street. The issue with this is we start to get into MDOT jurisdiction because of the ramps off 75, and there's some issues with that. So this one is a little bit more complex to deal with than the other ones. And the second node along Bigger is the John R. node. This was not a mid-block crossing, but improved the existing crossing at John R., striping and timing of signals and some other pedestrian improvements at the John R. Four-way stop there. The next short-term issue was the I-75 underpass. Has anyone actually done that walk before?
Yeah.
It's Brent and I do it occasionally. It's not a pleasant walk by any stretch of the imagination. It's dangerous and scary and dirty and gross.
Even with the new black fence. Now, the fence is nice, but it's a black fence.
Yes. So one of the issues is that the ramps coming off aren't at a 90 degree, and so it leads much more to kind of a rolling stop for cars moving through. So there's not a very clear separation of boundary between where the pedestrian area is and where the car stopping area is. So one of the issues they talked about was a 90 degree and actually reshaping the ramps coming off of 75 to be more 90 degrees. Soften the concrete edges of the underpass and increase lighting separation and landscaping and other elements. There's actually some graphic examples in the plan that shows how to do this. It's pretty cool.
Those graphic examples were really great. I thought they're perfect. That's what you need is an attraction. And if you could make it a more pleasant experience walking through there by lighting,
yep.
You know, that can't.
Lighting
goes
along.
I know lighting is expensive, but it's not.
But it can go a long way.
It really does.
And then another short term, these are not specific areas, but just kind of in general, all intersections, all major mile intersections should be looked at on Big Beaver, and install intersection treatments such as marked crosswalks, pedestrian countdown timers if they're not already installed. Encourage or think about the idea of a leading pedestrian interval, which basically you give the pedestrians a head start at a green light so that they can actually get into the intersection before you open the intersection off, so it just puts the pedestrians in a more visible location crossing the street.
Seems fair.
The issue with the leading pedestrian interval is it does diminish or does not allow for right on red turns, and that is a traffic issue that the county has raised. And lastly, corner radius design, just tighten at the corners so that cars can't make as quick a right turn at the intersections. Lighting and landscape improvements just all on the corridor. Lighting and landscaping should be looked at to be consistent and be more pedestrian feel. Brent mentioned the over the overhead lights. We still have a number of overhead lights. I think they're all overhead lights on Big Beaver, so trying to look for more pedestrian scale lighting. And lastly, one concept was to look at some increased transit and start with a pilot program of a trolley system that just runs up and down Big Beaver. Actually, a number of businesses have approached the city to talk about doing this, so that might have legs to get them in.
Would current businesses along Big Beaver be willing to supplement that funding in any way? Because it's their customers that they're bringing to them.
It would be a point of discussion that we've actually had internal discussions about approaching businesses. Nothing formal at this point.
No.
Long term was look at all the Big Beaver nodes, Coolidge Highway node, Crooks Road, Rochester Road, and then just a bunch of miscellaneous items, the feasibility of a streetcar bike share program, expanding the existing sidewalk on one side of Big Beaver to be a multi-use trail, typically 10 feet sidewalk to a multi-use trail, but right now it's only 8 feet wide, so looking at picking up 2 or more additional feet on one side. Long-term big vision would be to build pedestrian bridges across Big Beaver. It's a very expensive endeavor. We're not sure where the money for that would really come from.
Are there grants available for anything like that?
Not for that, really. And then lastly, try to do some placemaking outreach. City could create a Move Across Troy website, create corridor maps and pamphlets, wayfinding and directional signage, public art. or and add more events, so restaurant walk or close Big Beaver down for a biking or walking or racing events. And then there's some additional recommendations for law enforcement and drivers and businesses as well.
What's Cyclovia?
That's actually closed. It's closing the street down for a biking event.
I think. Oh.
Do you want this, Brent, or you want me to do
sure.
This?
So we've got to adhere to state law in terms of our master plan review and approval process, so that you've all been informed and reminded that we have a joint meeting with the City Council on the 23rd to talk about the master plan. And following that, the Planning Commission has to forward the plan to City Council for their review. And the City Council actually approves the plan for public distribution and review. And it's a 63-day mandatory public review period where we notify all surrounding communities, Oakland County and Semcog, that this plan is to be reviewed. And actually, Oakland County does a really good job of reviewing it and providing comments to us. Following that, we get the plan back, and the comments of the plan back. We hold a public hearing, make a recommendation, and forward it to the City Council for their adoption. And the 63-day review period puts everything on hold for 2 months.
Right.
We just sit and wait.
And that follows the City Council approval, right?
That follows them approving the plan for distribution.
Right. Is that a separate motion by them?
Yes.
Okay. Yes, Mr. Hudson. Yeah.
Maybe this is a segue. We're talking about the Civic Center as a node, as part of the process here. I think it was short term. We do this every 5 years. This one's stretched into 7 years. But I'm thinking for our next project, instead of waiting 5 years from today, I'd like to address a lot of focus at our master plan with the Civic Center complex, bounded by Town Center, Big Beaver, Livernois, and I-75.
Based on the dialogue we had at the last joint meeting, I think we're not going to wait 5 years to review the plan. We're going to regularly look at it. We're going to regularly consider hot button issues. And I think the next hot button issue is just exactly what you said, Kansas campus, and take a,
yeah,
kind of a big picture approach to what we can do for this campus moving forward.
This looks great. Nice work.
Great. I love the illustrations and the format, the text layout. It's very very professional. Thank
so
you.
Our goal is that when the 23rd is to actually give you the full master plan with the changes with the new chapters as well. So
okay.
A full complete draft.
Good.
Will that be on paper?
Well, let me address that.
Would you prefer that, Karen?
I would love to look at a draft of that magnitude on paper.
Okay.
Who else wants to kill trees?
If I want to make notes or mark on it, it's just...
That's the problem with the PDF format. You can put sticky notes in there, and I haven't even learned how to do that, but I guess it's fairly easy. But
you know, we have no problem providing a hard copy to whoever wants one.
So are you giving us the copy on the 23rd or sending it to us in advance of that meeting that we need to look at it
well,
by the 23rd? What
this will not, this should not change much at all.
Okay. Right.
The parts that really changed the master plan, which were, you know, what were in your packet, will not change. Simply what we'll be doing is uploading this into the rest of the document.
Right,
we'll be making small changes to that, just updating content. Our goal is to get it to you for the 23rd. Doesn't do you any good to get it the day of the meeting. So we're going to try our best to get it to you before the 23rd.
He did not use the word appendix
but
at any point in the last four
more
minutes.
Appendix,
that's
right.
Appendix.
That is the
appendix.
Week of Thanksgiving. That's
the Monday of Thanksgiving.
Oh.
That's what we signed up for, group.
Okay.
That's what we sign up for. Take it with you.
So.
Light reading.
Yeah.
And if you have any comments between now and then on what you've seen tonight, please feel free to get it to Brand or myself, and we'll implement it. Or
Yeah, I do have a question. We talked last joint meeting about the feasibility of changing the height requirement of Big Beaver. And I know we do this through a zoning ordinance. Shouldn't there be a segue somewhere between the master plan and that? Will that be included in our master plan?
That's already in there. It's that the concept of height, density, mixed use, height on the along the Big Beaver and stepping down away. That's already in there. Okay. We took the approach in the zoning ordinance to not be heavy-handed. Our assumption was there's a lot of different factors that went into it. We had the Monarch. I mean, was that the end of his top street? The Monarch was approved and fizzled out. The Pavilions was approved. Massive mixed use project fizzled out because of the recession. We had the Monarch. The building that was there was taken down. It was just kind of weeds and looking terrible. We had the Sterling. This is before anyone's time here. The Sterling Corporate Center, which was where the new Coza development, where the Bonefish and the Carrabba's was, that was conceptually approved for a 12-story mixed-use building. That went away. So we had these kind of these losses along Big Beaver. Then we had the recession. So we didn't want to take a really heavy-handed approach requiring the vertical mixed-use. So I would say that the policy is already in place with the master plan, so we don't have to go down that road. It's already there. We just have to change our approach from a regulatory implementation standpoint, and be more, if that's the way we want to go, and be more heavy-handed.
Okay. We really need to have developers and financial institutions be willing to do that kind of thing. And I know there's an effort already going on to bring that to fruition. And I think that's what we've got to do. We all remember the recent planning conference, and I think if we don't do those kind of things, we're going to be left behind.
Yeah, to that end, so we're trying to gather information about verticality along corridors, and I've contacted a number of people, and the person from Sam Schwartz Engineering who worked on the move across Troy, he's told, I asked him, are there any communities that are further ahead than us on our efforts along Big Beaver to create more of a world-class corridor, get less of a suburban corridor, more of a world-class corridor? And he said, we're blazing the path. We're leading. And we asked another expert. He's an architect. What is he, an architect? Bob?
He's actually a
landscape architect, but nationally renowned. He said we're leading the charge. You know, we're trying, and there's some great things happening on Big Beaver. But again, we all agree it could be more, it could be better, especially the stretch between Coolidge and 75. This is kind of the sweet spot.
Do you know anything about what's going on with the new Regional Transit Authority routes and the way they're planning that? I know that there's an initiative, I think it's called DRIVE, and it has an acronym. They're forming in January. Whatever's going on now is, and they're going to be announcing some of their, and how do their routes tie in, especially I was thinking about the Maple Corridor, to see how that connects us to downtown and other parts of the region.
Yeah, I'll have to brush up on that.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you.
I'll send you an email.
Yes, that'd be great.
I should introduce you to somebody who's involved in
something. That'd be great, thank you.
Anything else for Ben or Ben on this update? If not, we'll go to number 10, public comment for items on the current agenda.
Well, I have one.
This is your one opportunity.
I'm going to take off my Wilshire Muir Homeowners Association hat, put on my LDAFA board member hat. We're very excited about the idea of the pedestrian crossing across Big Beaver. The one thing I'm concerned about with that jog, which I understand is for safety, but the thing I'm concerned about is how that's designed is for snow removal. How does that, I mean, the city's going to have to get out there and keep the snow off that pedestrian crossing if we expect people to use it. And that's the one thing I'm concerned about.
Thank you. I'm sure it will be addressed. Okay, let's go to number 11, Planning Commission comment. Let's start with you tonight, Mr. Crit.
Nothing here.
Mr. Tingle.
Good, thank you.
Ms. Cruz?
The only immediate comment that I have is we've talked tonight about these neighborhood nodes and things that we want to see in Troy and the way we want Troy to look. I guess I'm just a little struck with the earlier comment with the hotels. If it's the missing middle housing that we need and we have limited available space, wouldn't we want to focus more on filling the need than building more hotels? Sort of my thought.
Yeah, I guess the only response that I have to that is that the developers who have the money and the financing and the application fee and all that, they control that.
But can't we say no?
I don't think so. You can say no to the actual things that don't meet the city code, but, you know, it's just like we discussed before. We don't have, there's nothing, no ordinance ever against designing ugly. No, there isn't.
Well, no, I know.
I don't think we want one, too.
Against designing ugly. I guess I'm just thinking, you know, as we talk about what we want, are we going to continue to be in situations where we allow development that we are not crazy about, or maybe that doesn't meet our needs, doesn't look the way we want it to look, and is not part of our vision, just because we can't say no? I mean, Brent, help me out here.
I'm going to speak in generalities and not about this particular type of use or development, because I haven't seen it and I can't speak
intelligently. Right, and I can't either, but I'm just thinking in my mind, we have vacant land and we're talking about needing this type of housing, and so can we not be picky?
Well, our existing laws, which is our ordinance right now, allows hotels, it allows residential, it allows all of that. So. You know, I think we can certainly, for there's market forces in place that people at this table know a lot more about than I do, that is resulting in hundreds and hundreds of more hotel rooms in the city. And at some point, the market isn't gonna support more. I don't know when that is. There seems to be a lot of rooms proposed for the, you know, that are under construction or proposed. I mean, we can look at incentivizing, encouraging. The missing middle isn't happening for whatever reason. I don't know what it is. I don't know. Carlton, do you have any theories as to why I'm putting you on the spot here, as to why the missing middle isn't taking off like it? I mean, the numbers back it, the demographics, the census data, it's available online. Clearly, there's a need for these. There's a need today, or there's going to be a need in the future for these types of uses. For whatever reason, it's not happening.
I don't know. But what occurred to me when you said that is, are there places where the missing middle is being built, and is their approach different?
Mm-hmm.
You know, in terms of incentives and zonings,
mm-hmm.
zoning and things like that. But no, I don't know why it's not happening here now. And I kind of agree with Don's comment on the hotels. It's the developer who puts the money at risk and makes the economic case, and they're able to build the business case for it. And it sounds like the missing middle business case isn't being built.
And even more importantly, to obtain the financing needs of that.
Because they've got the business case.
Right.
And it's what they do, and it's what they know. I agree. I sense your frustration, and trust me, we've had the same type of dialogue with every residential developer in Troy. Maybe the approach we're taking for our problem on Big Beaver where we're contacting people from not only regionally but nationally. We're reaching out. I mean, I reached out to someone in Atlanta last week. I reached out to someone in Savannah, Georgia last week. I reached out to someone in Washington, D.C. today to get input. We need to do a little bit more research, talk to more people, find out, like you said, Carl, great point, what they're doing in places where the missing middle is getting done. What are they doing that's different from what we're doing? I think it's going to takes a little bit more effort on our part. We can't just assume like we did when in 2011, we said, oh, the market's going to support vertical mixed use. Obviously, where it's Big Beaver, it's Troy. It'll support it. Well, for whatever reason, it's not happening. I think we have to take the same approach for the missing middle, possibly, and do some more investigation.
Have you contacted Hunter Richardson?
Yes, I have, from Atlanta, Georgia.
Okay.
What I'm going to do is I'm going to compile some of the comments, all the comments I get, and I'll share them with you.
And I really do applaud the staff for diligently pursuing this, you know, and recognizing the potential. And if at any point the staff believes that, you know, bringing in outside expertise will be of any benefit, I think this commission would certainly support you in that. Thank you. Okay, where were we?
Mr.
No comment.
Nothing for me.
Ms. Cooper.
Just to remind ourselves that we do have a very diverse community. November 11th is the Hindu holiday of Diwali. The temple and many others from the community will be coming to City Council on November 9th to receive our second or third annual Diwali proclamation that the city is putting out there. So it's celebrated by about a billion people around the world. Mm-hmm. And a lot of them live in Troy. So anyway, it's like the Festival of Lights is the way it's called, and so a lot of times people will put their Christmas lights up for Diwali, and then leave them up.
The nice part I like about it is it's way before our traditional Judeo-Christian Christmas. We have family in our neighborhood that they always win the homeowner's prize. Because not only do they decorate the front, they decorate the back of their house.
Yep, they decorate the whole house.
It's great. Mr. Hudson.
Nothing, thank you.
And I have nothing, so we are adjourned. Oh, I'm sorry, did you guys?
No.
Okay.